We have a daughter. We have a daughter as well, so it's getting pretty serious between us now. And it's our first kid. I don't know if it'd get too late in life. Sometimes I think so. Like, because if you ever ask someone that has kids and their kids are grown and moved out, and you're like, when's the best time of your life? They will say before they have kids or after their kids move out. There's like 20 years they don't mention. And that's when kids were in their house, you know? So for me, I'm 35. I was 33 when she was born. So by the time she moves out, I'll be 53. I'll be dead within hours. So, I've just pushed it too far. Like, I should have done it earlier, you know? Like, I watched that show Teen Mom, and I'm like, man, those girls are nailing it. Like, that's what... Just get it over with, you know? Like, no one likes junior high or high school anyway, so just wrap it all up together. If I had my daughter at 13, she'd be already moved out. Right now, she'd be gone. I'd already be done. I would be crushing it down here. So, we took her to Disney World, and she's two, and so when I took her, like, my stupid buddies that don't have kids, they're just like, why are you even taking her? It's not like she's going to remember it, you know? You're just, like, wasting money. And I was like, I don't know, but it's fun to see her get excited. I don't know, you know? I mean, should I just lock her in a closet and be like, do you remember yesterday? No? Well, until you start remembering things. I'm not going to waste any money on you, you know?
My father, they're both 62 years old. My father was 50. He looked like a light-skinned black dude. He's just a regular, fair-skinned, a little lighter than me, fair-skinned black dude. Over like the last 10, 12 years, my father has become a 5'7 Filipino man. I know it sounds awkward, but because it is. All my friends meet my dad and be like, yo, this Asian dude. This your dad right here? I'm like, yeah, you know, he didn't start off that way, but like. But that's who he became after loving for who he is, okay? And it's weird, because I'm like, hey, you know, fellas, this is my dad. They all, Mr. Bells. I'm like, he's not Asian. You know? You don't have to bow. What are you doing? And he dresses like an old Asian dude, too. You ever seen an old Asian dude, like at like North Park Mall or some shit? You ever seen an old Asian dude walking around? They just wear flowy clothes. They don't care about fashion. They just wear comfortable clothes. They just walk around the mall like this. They just walk around looking at architecture. All I want to do is, like, I just want to help him out because he just dresses weird right now. He just wants to wear comfortable clothes. All his clothes are so big. I'm like, I'm doing all right, man. Let me buy you some clothes. Man, I don't need no clothes. Yes, you do. My dad has one pair of jeans. One! One pair of jeans, he calls them the jeans. Oh, we going to the mall? Let me run upstairs and put on the jeans real quick. Stop, why are you walking backwards? Come here, don't do that, come here. I'm gonna go throw on the jeans. You going upstairs like that? You can go upstairs backwards, but I'm gonna put on the jeans real quick. Stop doing that. And they're so wide, they're wide as fuck. They're so wide. They're so wide. They don't touch his legs or his shoes. They don't touch his legs or... My father could do like this. They wouldn't touch shit. They would just hover around his calf muscles. He could drop a tennis ball from his waist to the floor. He wouldn't touch nothing. It would just... They're so wide. I'm always like, Dad, man, let me get you some new pants, man. I don't need no pants. I'm like, well, what do you want? Give me some DVDs. What? Why do you want DVDs? I collect DVDs. Why? They're not collector's items. I know the box says that, but that's marketing. They don't mean that shit. My father, in my house, Decatur, Georgia, my father has an 8x10-foot shelf. Just straight DVD. It's crazy. He thinks when people stop by, they're impressed by this shit. Hey, how you doing? You look good. How's your wife? You see my DVDs? And they're organized by actor. That's not a joke. They're organized by actor, and if two big actors share a movie, he buys two copies so they can share it together. It's ridiculous. And I got him all the, you know, all the streaming services, he has all the movies he can get just online. I'm like, Dad, I got you Netflix, Amazon, Hulu, HBO shows. I got you all that shit. Why are you still buying DVDs? He goes, first of all, thank you. Second of all, what if the power goes out? Hmm? Yeah, you right. Because I know he meant Wi-Fi. I know he meant Wi-Fi. God damn, I hope he meant Wi-Fi. I just got to find a way to get him out of these pants, man. It's goddamn. Because like, these jeans, look at, oh my God. If you saw them, you'd be like, they don't sell these in stores. This is not, you can't just buy these at a place, okay? You got to know somebody in the alley. And a special night, you gotta go. Fuck you on. Hey man, I came to buy some pants to embarrass my family. Do you have what I'm looking for? Man, hey, get your ass here. We got exactly what you're looking for. We got jeans on the left, DVDs on the right. So do whatever you want.
I will say this, if I could tell you one thing to take away tonight, is to don't do anything to impress other people. Do it to impress yourself. I learned that the hard way, man. I ran the LA Marathon trying to impress my dad. That's a long way to go for respect, man. Holy moly. But I wanted to impress my dad. I've never done anything like that. And it's like, look, there's some things I can't explain to immigrant parents. My dad is from Mexico, and there's certain things I can't explain to him. Like, one time I bought a pair of ripped jeans. I thought it looked great. I put them on, about to leave. I'm like, all right. And my dad stopped me at the door. Hey, Jesus, don't go nowhere, man. Your pants are ripped. He scared me. I'm like, what? No, I bought them this way. He said, that's okay. Keep the receipt. That happened to me one time. I'm like, no, Dad, I bought them this way. What? So you bought pants to make it seem like you have a harder job than you do? He said, no one's gonna believe you ripped the pants telling jokes. Good point. He said, that's the problem with your generation, millennials. He said, you do things to impress other people. He said, would you buy a brand new car that's already dented? I'm like, if it's cool, hell yeah, I would. He told me, he's like, hey, have a seat, I wanna talk to you. All right. He goes to his closet, opens it up, he shows me stacks of ripped jeans he doesn't wear anymore because they're ripped. He's like, look at this, you don't see me wearing it. And I'm like, what size are they? He's like, shut the hell up, man. My mom felt bad that my dad was giving me a hard time about the jeans. So again, I go on the road, I come back like a week later. You know what my adorable mom did? She got all my ripped jeans and just sewed them up. What do you say to that?
Thank you.
Certain things you can't explain, man. Abstract art. To my parents' generation, art looked like art, you know? They don't have an appreciation for other things that are like, what is this, you know? So I have a friend, talented artist, his name's Taylor, and I went to one of his shows, and he sold out on all his abstract art, and it was beautiful, man. I was so happy. I was like cheering for him. I'm like, man, this is awesome. But he had one piece left. He's like, no, I didn't sell one. I'm left with one piece. I said, oh, that's awesome. He's like, I'm gonna give it to you. I said, no, you don't have to. I couldn't afford it. He's like, no, I'm giving it to you. Thank you for coming out. I'm like, oh, shit, thank you, man. So I was so happy. This is my first ever art piece. You know, I grab it, I go home, and I put it up on my wall. And I'm so proud, man. This is my first art piece. And all it is, it's a big white square, red triangle, yellow rectangle, red circle, squiggly line, abstract art. You know what I mean? And I'm proud. I'm just soaking it in. I'm like, wow, this is beautiful, man. And then I hear my dad's slippers walk into the room just... And I don't even want to turn around because I can feel the heat from my dad's eyes on my neck. just burning a hole, just I don't know what it is. My dad's always chewing something, just, you know. And I could hear it behind me, just, and then. But I don't want to turn around. I'm just letting him wait. Finally, he can't take it no more. He's like, what the hell is this? Like, Dad, I didn't even know you were there. You know. He's like, what is this? I'm like, oh, this is abstract art. He's like, who gave you that? I'm like, oh, my friend gave it to me. He's like, hold your friend, five. Yeah, I can see why you think that, but no, he's like 30-something years old. Oh, okay, so he did this when he was younger or something. No. He's like, is he gonna finish it? I'm like, it's done, Dad, it's done. This is it.
You know when your parents just say shit that when you were a kid, you're like, oh, you never used to say shit like that when I was a kid. Like, my mom was like, well, I'm gonna leave the house. What are you gonna do for the weekend? And my dad was watching TV and he turns and he goes, eat steak, watch porn. I applaud the honesty out of that guy. Really sharp, I appreciate that. Tell her the truth, man. They're getting older, you know what I mean? They get older, but I love that about these people. They're fantastic, they raised me. I mean, did they raise me correctly? I don't know, maybe not. I grew up here in downtown Chicago for half of my life in Chicago, and the second half we moved to the western suburbs, right? We moved to the suburbs because my sister was born and my parents were like, I'm not gonna fuck up two of them. We can't do that. One's good, we'll fuck up one, that's okay. But we moved to the western suburbs, you know, and to try to better the life of all of us. But like, I still realize sometimes how like my mom used to fuck with us subtly. Like, my mom is crazy. She's a crazy person in the best way. But she would like lay it in real slow. Like, my parents were somewhat religious, right? You know, I mean, Irish Catholic, kinda, you know what I mean? Like, you, like, it, somewhat in, you know what I mean? You're like, in the hot tub, maybe. But she used to do this thing. She used to make me say every single night before I went to bed, now I lay me down to sleep. Do you know that? Does anybody know that? I used to have to say this. Like, I used to have to repeat this. I'd say, now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. And if I die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. I would say that before bed, which is a really fucked up thing for a child to say out loud. If I die before I wake up, I'm six. I'm gonna die in the middle of the night. And God's gonna leave my body, take my soul, but be like, body's good, leave the body, it's fine. Leave it. What's going on? Crazy person. I love her, she's the best in the world. I had Irish Catholic guilt. I had so much Irish Catholic guilt when I was a kid, I used to flip a coin to determine whether or not I was gonna masturbate that day. Huh? You think I'm kidding? I would take a quarter, I would go heads, yes, tails, no. I'd flip it, I get tails, and I go, best two out of three. We gotta go again. Let's see what happens. He didn't beat me, never won. That's how heavy my guilt was. Seriously, that's how, like, in my head I was about that God is watching you type of stuff. Like, my mother used to let us not lock the doors. She was against that. She's like, you don't lock the doors inside of the house. If you're locking the doors inside of the house, it means you're doing something you shouldn't be doing. Yeah, that's why we lock the doors. Don't come in here. I'm pulling on my body, get out of here. Leave me alone, lady. That's how I realized, the guy that invented locks inside of a house must have been caught masturbating by his wife one too many times. Was sick of it, he was sick of it. He's like, you know what, that's it. I'm gonna put locks inside the house. She's like, Michael, what are you doing? We have locks on the outside of the house to keep criminals from coming inside. There's no criminals inside of this house. Yes, there are, Karen. And they're robbing me of my freedom. Let me pull on my body in peace. Leave me alone, Karen. Anyway, I love being from this city. And now I live in Los Angeles, California. I live on the other side of this great country. I like it out there, it's okay. It's a second home for me. It takes some getting used to. It's a little bit difficult. But the big difference is like when I come back home, you know, like all my mom wants to do is talk about like the weather. Like that's a big thing. My mom is like, how's the weather in California? Is it nice like this? It's like, yeah, it's better than this. That's why I'm out there. What are you talking about? It's always better. It is. There's a lot of stuff that isn't better, but the weather's always gonna be better. And she loves bringing up the feels like meter. You know what that is? The news guy. The news guy's like, it's 62. Feels like 68. That's Midwest hope. That's hope circulating in your body. That's the greatest lie ever told. Who's the feels like guy? I want that job. If that's a job, I want it tonight. I'll drop this bullshit gig and go do that tonight. The feels like guy, greatest gig ever. Here in the studio, it's 62 on the barometer. We're gonna go live to Andrew Santino. Andrew, what does it feel like? How's it going, news team? Like 67, right back to you guys. Right back to you guys, man. It's nice, really nice out.
I made a terrible parenting choice a while back I feel pretty bad about. My daughter, Monroe, she turned 11 earlier this year, and her entire childhood, she'd been doing speech therapy, like going back to preschool. But for the previous 2 years prior to 11, she could say every single sound perfectly, except for the R sound. And I was getting frustrated with her, because I thought she was just not doing her exercises. I thought she just wasn't doing her homework. Essentially, I'm a maniac, and I thought that my daughter had a speech impediment because she was lazy. And I was getting after her. I was like, come on, Monroe. I'm like, you gotta work on it. All right, you gotta do the exercises. They give you homework assignments for a reason. You actually have to try. And she'd be like, Dad, I am Twine. And I would think, horrible shit. Well, not Twine very hard. Finally took her to a new speech therapist early this year. I have no idea why the first person never did this test. They ran a different test, found out that she's physically tongue-tied in a way that makes it literally impossible for her to make the R sound. She could work on it for 10 hours a day, every single day, for the rest of her life, and never get it. And luckily, that's not where this story ends, because that'd be a fucking bummer. How pissed would you be if I took you down that entire road just to be like, yeah, so it sucks, you know? It's gonna be a hard life, no one's gonna take that seriously. Hi, my name is Moe, I'll be your attorney. No, you won't. I'm not gonna hire a lawyer who can't say their own name correctly. No, it gets way better. This new therapist told us about a frenectomy. I don't know why the first person ever brought this up. It's just a simple outpatient procedure. They laser the frenulum that connects your tongue to the bottom of your mouth so your tongue can move naturally and you can make all your sounds. And so we have that done. 2 weeks later, Monroe is perfectly pronouncing everything. Crushing R's. She will speak better than I can for the rest of her life. And when she found out that she could, you know, finally say things the way she wanted to say, she was so happy slash furious. Right, like happy she could speak correctly, a little irritated that for the past 2 years, her dad had been doing the parental equivalent of just yelling at a blind child for not being able to see. Just a monster, just squint it out already. Get rid of that dumb stick if you'd squint harder. She's probably gonna be showing off her R abilities for the rest of her childhood now. Dad, would you like to hear my sounds again? Yeah, go ahead, Monroe, let's see what you got. I cannot believe my father never considered other treatment options whatsoever. Are my R's clear now, motherfucker? Yeah, good job, Monroe, I felt that last one. And sometimes I'm too hard on my kids. Usually, I'm too hard on my kids because I'm worried about being too soft. Man, I hate soft parenting. I feel like soft parenting ruins people. Right? Truly, truly. Too many parents afraid to criticize or discipline. They just want to tell their kids how awesome they are all of the time. You ever met somebody who was only told they were awesome by their parents? 100 out of 100 times, not awesome. Delusional. No self-awareness. Right, just saying things that prove they have no sense of reality all the time. Just, what did you say? Did you actually just say that you're a social media influencer? You think that's what you do? You have 42 followers on Instagram and a part-time job at Arby's. You're barely a roast beef influencer. I've met adults that were clearly ruined by overly supportive parents. I'll never forget this one guy I met early on doing stand-up. It was an open mic. It was an amateur night. And anybody who showed up, put their name on a list, got to do 10 minutes. And this one guy, he showed up with his mom. Only his mom. So red flag riding shotgun already. And he does his 10 minutes to silence from the audience. He just eats it for 10 minutes. No one in the audience laughs at a single one of his jokes other than his mother, who cackles like a hyena the entire time. And he comes off stage, and I overheard him say, like, I don't know what that crowd's problem was. Those jokes were awesome. My mom thought I did great. And I decided to do him a hard favor right then and there. I stabbed his mom right in her fucking neck. And while she bled out, I pulled him close. You're free, baby bird! Now you have a chance! No, but I probably should have. Now, I did think that his mom, you know, probably ruined any chance he had at a career in comedy. And maybe I was right. He wasn't even doing stand-up 2 years later, you know, because he didn't work on his jokes. Why would he? Mom already told him that they were awesome. My mom didn't hurt my comedy career that way. She never gave me any fake compliments. I know exactly what my mom thinks about my act to this day. She doesn't care for it. Like, don't get me wrong, she loves me. She's happy that I can make a living at this. No part of her understands how I'm pulling that off. My comedy is not her style at all. She thinks it's too mean, too violent, too dark, you know, too dirty, too much profanity. And I love my mom. I love my mom, but my mom can suck my dick, you know what I mean? Figuratively. See how much she likes that joke. No, but I'm glad she didn't give me just a bunch of easy compliments, you know, because she made me work harder to prove her wrong. You know, my daughter Monroe, right now, she's a pretty good artist. And I'd like to think that part of the reason she's become a pretty good artist is due to my criticism of a lot of her earlier work. Because when she was younger, you know, she had talent, but I was watching the rest of the family ruin it by just giving easy compliments. And she's a smart kid. She's always been really smart. She figured out at an early age she could spend 2 minutes on something or 2 hours and get the same compliments. So why work hard? Why put in that extra effort, you know? She could just scribble some nonsense, hand it to a family member, and just hear, what? You did this on your own? Monroe, this could be in an art gallery. I'm looking at the same thing thinking, that's not gonna make the fridge. One time she handed me something so bad, I couldn't even tell what it was, and she got mad at me. She's like, what do you think? And I was like, I don't even know what this is supposed to be. It's a dog. We have a dog right there. I want you to look at that dog, look at this, look at me, and say that again with a straight face. That dog goes missing, guess who I'm not putting in charge of the posters?
Oh, my dad has swag, man. He's 74 years old and he walks around the house like this, you know what I mean? And he's always laughing, he's like, yeah, 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 yeah. And he's always pointing that shit that's not there. He's like, yeah, 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 yeah. Like, my dad's a special man, you know? Like, he taught me lessons in 5 seconds or less. You know, he didn't sit me down and have long conversations. 9 years old watching cartoons, my dad walks in and goes, son, don't talk about it, be about it, and just left the fucking room. There's another reason my dad has swag. This black man has a PhD in nuclear physics. Right? Now I hear the Asian people, oh, okay. Black man plus PhD equal white man. My mom. My mom, calm down. My mom, she was born and raised in Korea, Southside. Now we know who doesn't watch the news in this room. But here's the thing about Asian women. They don't have filters. If they think it, they say it, it flies out their mouth. If you don't believe me, go to the airport. They all got masks over their mouths, just walking around. Talking shit about people like, oh, you so stupid, you so dumb. Oh, your purse is fake. My mom has no filter. That's what I'm saying. No filter, man. I was 12 years old. My mom buys me my first pet. It's a little black Cocker Spaniel. I was so excited. I was like, Mom, what should we name it? She looks at the dog and goes, well, it's black. Let's name it Blackie. You can't name a black dog Blackie, Mom. That's racist. She go, oh, so funny, so funny. I racist, okay. You know you have black dad, right? So I live in Houston, Texas, in an all-white neighborhood, predominantly racist with a dog named Blackie. I didn't care. I was having the time of my life with the dog in the front yard. It's dinner time. My mom comes out and goes, hey, Blackie, come home. Even the racist white people were like, God damn, that bitch is racist. Oh, man. My dad met my mom, and then they had me. Oh, he's right. Look how old I look in this photo. I look younger now than I do in this photo. I am the real life Benjamin Button. Look at this. I look like an old Asian man that just died. I'm 2 days old in this photo. How is my hairline receding? It's all right, man. My parents made it work. They told me I always belong, man, and I could be anything in America. You know what I mean? That's right. I love them. I love them. I love them so much. I mean, I was the happiest kid around. I mean, look at this smile. Look how big those teeth are, man. I'm 8 years old in this photo. My teeth are 46.
My father didn't give a shit. He would tell us the same story every week. You children, come here. Have to tell you something. We're like, wow, what has he got to tell us? It's very important. Important. He liked to pronounce it very important. You children are lucky you are here in this country. We're like, oh, man. It's 4:30 in the morning, too? Shit. And you better be awake. Me and your mother, like we didn't know who she was. Came to this country. He was very dramatic, with no money. No money. Came to the airport naked. They asked for my passport. I said, here, take this. Like, really? You really are the Lion King. Lion motherfucker, you didn't do that. And they always, like, immigrants always exaggerate. We came one penny between us. You got $100. Get the fuck out of here. One penny. You wouldn't have made it here if you had one penny. So we say, you're here. You have no excuse to fail. No excuse. Okay? You can be whatever you want to be. Don't forget, you can be whatever you want to be. And we're like, we like to be asleep. You didn't say it out loud. My father beat your ass. You can be whatever you want to be. So, you know, no excuse to fail. So one day, on a bus, going to school, School bus breaks down. Boom. It's cold as fuck out. I tell people how cold it is in Chicago, in New York, they don't get it. I go, you're not understanding.
My dad ate a banana without peeling it once. I'm not kidding. I was 15. I came home. I was playing baseball. I didn't even know these guys that well. He's in the middle of the kitchen, just his underwear, already a disaster. Taking shark bites out of a tight skin Chiquita. Just. And I come home, my buddy John, who was the tough guy in our group, he'd always walk in chest first. He comes walking in, he like, he's not afraid of anything. He sees my father, he goes, there's a giant in your kitchen eating a banana. I was so embarrassed. I ran out, I was like, Dad, what are you doing? What are you doing? My father goes, I'm in a rush. Fucking, the gorilla's in a rush. You gotta go outside. Oh, but this is the point I'm making. I wasn't afraid of anything. It's just a different dude. We got in a car. We got in a car, man, and it was just he and I, and the windows were rolled up, and there was a hornet. A hornet. I'm not talking about yellow jacket. I'm talking about a hornet, okay? Hornets. The kind that live in the ground. They're not even part of the ecosystem. You know those ones with the two abdomens and the fur and the armor, horns? You can see their stingers. They're not even part of the ecosystem. They were put on the earth to sting a man for his sins. You know those, what? That's the only thing they're there for. They don't have anything to do. Because a honeybee stings you like, and you're like, ow, and it dies. It's very sad. Not so the hornate, not so. No. They find the sinner. They grab you here, bite, and they hum sting you 50 times. That way, they empty your sack, your face melts, you can't have an open casket. You can Google it. I don't give a shit. Anyway. So, I'll never forget this, man. This is when I get in the car, and I see the hornate. It's got two abdomens. It's fur, a hell red fur, and orange, and the stinger's a little thicker than my fingers, I think, and horns. And I looked at it. We looked at each other. Its eyes were as black as the blackest night. And I knew then it was going to kill me. I knew, I understood that it was my time. And he began to run toward me. And I forgot my hands. I didn't know how to use my hand. I couldn't get my hands to work. And I tried to get out, and my father, with his giant non-cell phone dialing fingers, just caught it. He just went and broke its bones. Just, I heard it. Those things, they die hard. That thing died like, fuck you, you know? And my dad was going like that with his fingers. And I was like, I was a mess. I was like, what the fuck? And my father goes, and he was doing this. I go, that thing sting you? And my father goes, I don't know. Probably. It's not a philosophical question. And this is when you know the difference. Like I was like, many years later, I was on a date with this girl, and I liked her. I remember I cleaned the inside of my car out. I was excited. Like, I know, right behind my, like I was acting cool, but just below the surface of my skin, I was like, ah! You know, but cool otherwise. And we get in the car, and it's going well. She's laughing at my jokes. She was an actress, so I was lying about celebrities I knew. It was beautiful. And I'm about to start the car. You know those days when you're like, everything is right in the world, and I'm about to start the car. And that same hornet was on my dashboard, and this thing was even bigger. It had feathers, I think, I can't remember. And it turns, and it looks at both of us, and I remember my girl, my beautiful girl, she chipmunked up. She just went, oh my God, please help me. I'm so allergic. And I was like, oh, you know. And I drive like this. I would always drive like this to show a woman I'm in control. Here, one hand, plus she can see the belly of the whale. It's a technique. I give it to you. Take it. But anyway, but you got to understand, this is an emergency situation. My girl's in danger. I was raised by, my father was a Marine. My mother was a Sicilian woman from Brooklyn. That is a very macho, old-fashioned culture. My mother raised me old-fashioned. She said, if you are with a woman, you are responsible for her safety. I don't care what the situation. I don't care if it's a bear. I don't care if it's two dudes with baseball bats. You are her shield. And that's how I am. That's what I say to my girl. I'm always like, listen, man, if there's a dangerous situation, you get behind this right cheek right here. You clip on. Clip on this belt loop. Not with these jeans because they're expensive as shit, but stay stay close here. And I'm moving. I use my elbows when I fight. I don't use my hands a lot of times because I need my hands for music and lovemaking. So I play the harp and stuff. It doesn't matter. Stringed instruments are my thing. But that's how it is, man. It's the first thing I said to my wife. I'm like, you want to be with me? I'm not like other guys. You want to be with me? You got to be into money, big dicks, and having a human shield. Because that's how it is.
My father's either pissed off or asleep. I asked him, I said, Pop, how come you're so angry?
Helps to hold down the rage.
My father's got exquisite anger. Just, it's total communication. You're never gonna look at my father and think, I wonder what's on his mind. I got arrested when I was 16 years old. Kid stuff, stole a car. So. Local cops find me, say, come on, kid, we're gonna take you home. No. Lock me up, give me the chair, but don't wake my father up. They take me to the station, they call my father. Mr. Farrar, we have your son here at the 4th precinct. Eh? Keep him. He made me spend the night in jail. In the morning, I heard the truck pull up. I looked out of the cell. Out of the corner of the cell, I see him. He's signing. He didn't say a word. He's just sitting. He looks into the cell and just goes, a 20-year police captain opened up the bars like this.
Oh, fuck!
I get my communication skills from my father, too, which is nothing. Absolutely nothing. He's 66 years old. He's down to grunts at this point in his life. He said, Pop, you hungry? Pop, you cold? Pop, how'd the Mets do? And that's what killed my relationship. Well, that'll kill any relationship if you can't communicate. That's the key to a relationship. That's how you build intimacy, through communication. It's very important to talk and listen to your partner so you can both grow as a unit.
And when life goes through little things,
you can really be prepared. It's just talking and talking and talking. And I was listening to every word because I thought, you know, there was a point. There's no point. You know, some people hire maids, they hire nannies. I should have hired a gay guy for her to talk to. Because there were so many things I just didn't care about. Should we reupholster this couch or get a new one? I don't know what to do with this room. What do you think?
Ramon, you're up.
Let's go, you're on the clock. It was a psychotic, babbling conveyor belt of nonsense. I went to get my nails done, but they didn't have the polish I want, so they put on clear coat, but it obviously has a pink tinge to it. Look at that. Doesn't that look pink to you? I told them to square off the tips, but they round them. I don't speak Korean. How the hell am I supposed to communicate? And Ramon would come running in. What are you doing? You can't talk to him like that. His head will explode. Why does she do that, Ramon? I don't know, honey, but I'm here now. Come on, you come with me now, baby. I'ma sit you on the couch. I pour you a little tequila. We put on ESPN. You watch the rednecks play poker. You like that, puppy, yeah. Thank you, Ramon. I wish you had a vagina. I know, honey, so do I.
I grew grew up in a house that by the time you were 9, if you got my dad a beer, your reward was a sip. I'm pretty sure that's not in any parenting handbooks today. Here, take a sip of that. Don't tell your mother, that's my boy. And the old man knew what he was doing, because by the 4th beer, I was going for him. I got you, babe. You need one? I'll get him right over there. By the time I was 12, his buddies had come over. I'd come out in the living room like a vendor. Beer here. Oh, beer. Thank you, beer. Everybody in L.A. gives their kids medicine. That's how they parent. They go, oh, he had ADD. We had to give him some Ritalin. That's him drooling right there with the crayon. We didn't have Ritalin. You know what happens when you had ADD when I was a kid? My dad would get an inch from your face and go, pay attention! Oh, God. I'm cool. It got away from me for a minute, but I'm all right now. I'm okay. That medicine's ridiculous, man. See, their goal is to get us to take a pill for everything we do. Right? They want us to take a pill for everything. Here's a pill to eat. Here's a pill to shit. Here's a pill to fuck. Here's a pill to sleep. Here's a pill that'll offset your eat, sleep, shit, and fuck pill. Here, take it. Are you kidding me, man? You think the guys that were about to storm the beach at Normandy were wandering around on the boats going, I feel a little anxious about what we're about to do here. No, because there's an old guy going, lock and load, motherfuckers, we're going in. Don't get me wrong, some people need medicine. Like, if you're having thoughts in your head like, I should cut open a cat and wear it like a hat, you need medicine. But everybody else, let's suck it up just a little bit, all right? I don't trust medicine. I don't trust new medicine. You know why? Because the FDA doesn't care about us anymore. They're in bed with all the pill makers. They just want to make money off us. They're just making stuff up, man. They're making it up. Those diseases don't exist. Shaky leg disease. Give me a break, really, sis. Stop drinking Red Bull with your vodka, you dick. It's that simple. It's shaky leg disease. Really? And they don't test it anymore either. Nobody tests anything. That's the problem, right? Because when they tell you about a new medicine, they tell you what it's supposed to do. Then that creepy little guy's voice comes on and tells you what it's really going to do to you. Right? Like, we don't hear that part. Take Zoloft for anxiety and depression. Then you hear that guy's voice. May cause bleeding from the ass. I'd rather be sad than leak. I'm pretty sure if I was leaking, I'd be sad. What's got you down, Bill? My ass is leaking.
It's so much important stuff I got to do now. I can't even, like, entertain people that was born 20 years later. I can't do it. I got to look out for my parents. You got to figure out what they're talking about half the time. Hey, man, you okay? I said, yeah.
You sure?
Yeah.
You all right?
Yeah. Why you keep asking? What you hear?
Well, you live in California, don't you?
Yeah,
I'm watching the news. Look like that shit on fire.
I said, Dad, that we good. That was a long time ago. We good.
Oh, well, you know, I DVR the news, so I'm just catching up. I said, well, that ain't the way to watch the news, Daddy. You way behind then. You know. Okay, all right, well.
Hey, I was wondering, I'm sitting there, I'm like, why don't Sylvester Stallone do something about the fire? Who? Sylvester Stallone. Why would Sylvester Stallone do anything about the fire, Dad?
He the governor, ain't he? No, Daddy, he not the governor. I don't know why you would think okay. You mean Arnold Schwarzenegger. That's what you mean. And he not even the governor no more, Daddy. You need to catch up on the damn news. That's... I know who I'm talking about. I'm talking about Rocky. No, Arnold Schwarzenegger is the Terminator. Yeah, Rambo. Okay, put Mama on the phone. How about that? We're not gonna do this shit all day. Put Mama on the phone. She ain't no better. Hey, baby. Hey, Mama, you okay? I'm good. I miss you. I miss you, too. Oh, what's your next city? Well, I'm actually about to be in Glendale, film a comedy special. Oh, do great. Where is that? I said, it's right outside of L.A. Oh, okay. Well, how far is it? Well, it's 45 minutes sometimes, and sometimes it's 4 hours. It just depends on, you know, it's L.A. Well, what I really called about was your uncle. I want you to come home and take a look at him. He not doing well. He got the Zika virus.
The what?
The Zika virus. Mama, nobody got that no more. I don't think he got the Zika virus. Well, you know how he was living, so if anybody was gonna get it, he got it. He got the Zika virus, yes. How he get it? He got stung by a bee. Okay, put Daddy on the phone. How about that? That ain't how you get it. Put Daddy on the phone. Hey, man, you still there? Mm-hmm. You sure? Mm-hmm. Listen, next time you come home, I want you to look in my backyard. They done cut down half my trees, rezoned everything, and put a gym up for the Mexicans. You still there? Mm-hmm. You heard what I said? Mm-hmm. Why you think the gym is for the Mexicans, Dad? It say La Fitness on the front. I took Spanish in the 8th grade. You don't think I know shit. I know shit. I'm bilingual. I'm smarter than you. Okay, calm down. Calm down. You bipolar, you not bilingual, calm down.
My middle kid, she's really funny, really funny. And she's clever, probably the most clever one of the bunch. Here's the irony of her being clever, is she's got the brewer look. Yeah, you know the look, the one that half you've been judging that you never see me live, like, wow, he comes on stage looking like that. So, and I didn't realize how funny this look was until I saw my daughter staring at a butterfly for an hour. And she, thank God that social services weren't doing spot checks. I would have been in bad trouble, like, oh my goodness, we got a child, I don't know what she's on the front. So this kid looks wrecked. She's, and her face is all relaxed. She can't even speak. I go, what are you doing?
A butterfly. A butterfly, Dad, a butterfly.
And this lady pulled up, and she gets out of the car, and she's concerned for my daughter. She's coming up to my door, and I'm watching. She's going, sweetheart! There's something wrong with this child, Charlie. Sweetheart, are you okay? What's going on with you today? She doesn't even acknowledge her.
She's a butterfly.
Did someone give you a brownie today? There's something wrong with this child. Call the police. Who is with this child? And then that's when I have to come out.
Excuse me. She's with me, and we're checking out butterflies, if you want to join us. You're a butterfly.
You laughing at my kid's face?
By the time you hit the third one, I find myself lying just to not deal with it. You know, the poor kid will come like, Dad, can we go to the park? Oh, man, it's closed. I wanted to go, and I Googled it, said closed. It's a beautiful day. And then I got in the car, and it's broke down. The only thing working is the game that Dad's watching. It's so annoying. So annoying. It's aggravating. It's not fair. It's not fair. You know? But because you can't reason with kids. I don't reason with a kid. My daughter hits the floor and starts whining. I just step right over them. I go, let me know that works out. This is a high kidnapping area, so be careful.
I was raised here in Texas, so, you know, my dad raised me to take care of my wife, you know. I don't mind taking care of my wife. My wife doesn't even pump her own gas. However, I do have a problem with the fact that she doesn't appreciate it. She expects it. You know why she expects it? Because she's a daddy's girl. Yep, her daddy did everything for her. You're already laughing. Oh, all I hear at my house, my father, my daddy. Oh, you don't know how to do it? My daddy does. My daddy knows. My daddy knows how to do everything better than you. Oh, if my daddy would have done that shelf, it would have come out better, my daddy. I ask her, I'm like, hey, baby, how come you don't wash your car? My daddy would never allow me to wash the car. How come you don't take out the trash? These hands have never touched trash. My father would not allow me to touch trash. I go, that's good, baby. Can you make me a sandwich? I'm not your mother. Well, my mother would never allow these hands to make a sandwich. It's true. I'm a mommy's boy. I still go home to this day so that my mom can make me a sandwich. And it's the best damn sandwich on planet Earth. Let me tell you how it works. I sit down, right? I watch TV with my dad. And then I go, Ma, sandwich! And she moves. Okay, you want a sandwich? I'll make you a sandwich. She moves. And there's lettuce and tomatoes and onions, salt and pepper, mayo and mustard evenly spread. She rolls the turkey. She don't lay it out flat like an asshole. And she brings it to me on a plate, a real life plate. And she follows it with, and what do you want to drink? Oh. How about some iced tea, Ma? I don't have any, but I'm going to make you some. I know. Because you love me. And every bite of that sandwich is the best. And it's so good. You know why? Because her secret ingredient is love and compassion. My wife makes me sandwiches with anger and hate. Here's your sandwich. Like, can you at least line the breads up? Like, on a paper towel. Well, I'm not gonna dirty dishes for you. Well, can I have some iced tea? I don't know, can you leg show? Let me see. I had a guy one time at a show and he yelled out, you should have married a Mexican girl. I did. They don't make them like they used to.
All these entertainment sites posted these pictures of Jason Momoa, and they all had similar commentary in the headlines. It was all like, Jason Momoa runs on the beach rocking his dad bod. In no world does Jason Momoa have a dad bod. If anything, it's a you're not my real dad bod, which is the body type of the first guy your mom hooks up with after the divorce. And maybe you're not ready for her to be back out there, but she is, so let her have it. She raised you, she deserves to be happy.
Yeah, I don't want to paint my dad to, like, he's not an asshole. I love my dad. He's a great dude. He taught me a lot about being a man, you know. And he did hug me. Like, I don't want to act like he was just not affectionate. He did, man. My dad hugged me. It was the 12th of October. tooth. No, he did hug me a bunch. But even the hugs I remember from Dad were always tinged with an element of, like, I'm still a man, you know? Like, hug me, but like, like a fucking, oh, I'm going to get you. Which at the time felt fun, but now looking back, I'm like, maybe that sound was just the sound of my dad pushing through an emotional barrier, you know, to get to the affection. Like, all right, I'm going to hug my, like a weightlifter, you know, I'm going to hug my son now. Mum's there spotting him. Don't worry, Derek, you're all right. Just hug your son. You're okay. Don't hurt yourself.
I'll admit it. Not having a dad, I was a delinquent. 13, I got arrested. I'll never forget the cop says to me, how would you like to end up like one of these guys on a poster? I'm going, at least he's wanted. What do you feel sorry for? You think I'd be doing this for a living if I was normal? You're paying for my issues. I make up for it, though. I love being a dad, man. I do stuff that dads would never do in other generations. Well, first of all, I stayed. But yeah, I'm there for the kids, you know, that's right. So I'm already off to a good start. But I do stuff like Mommy Me. I take Mommy Me classes because I'm off during the day, meet a bunch of moms, we're all in a circle, you know, and I'm the only guy in there. They think I'm part of the group, they breastfeed in front of me, but I'll admit it, I'm peeking. We're singing nursery rhymes. Ryan's mom is smoking hot, smoking hot. Bobby's nanny just bent down, just bent down. That's a true story. I change diapers, that's right. That's not a man's job, and I'll tell you what. Here's the thing, ladies. You have a better nose than we do. You know, men don't have a good sense of smell. My wife, she can smell pee 2 blocks away. Not me. I got my son Jackson the other day. I got him, I'm like hovering around. I can't tell if he is. And I go, all right. I'm like a DA raid. I'm going in. Fire! Man, they should make clear diapers. That's what I say. They need to fix this, I'm telling you. They have so much technology, right? How about if he has a poop, the diaper sends you a text message? You could call it shitter. I'm more than just a comedian. I am an entrepreneur. Hell, they have equipment for everything. Oh, you have to have all the baby equipment. Here's my life in a nutshell. I'm hanging out with my single friends at this outdoor cafe. They're checking out all the girls. My one friend goes, whoa, look at the rack on her. I'm going, look at that stroller she's pushing. Got the baby monitor. Oh, my wife is on that monitor like Anne Frank in an attic listening for Nazis. I'm sorry. Too soon. There's so much equipment now. They have baby Mozart. Yeah, they put Mozart in their crib, a machine. It's supposed to help them sleep and make them smarter. If things changed, when I was a kid in my crib in Philadelphia, I was listening to my great aunt, chain smoker Marlboro Red, singing me a lullaby.
When the bell breaks, cradle will fall. Down will come Craggy. Here, play with my smoke ring. Look, the Olympic symbol.
Too much equipment, man, I'm telling you. They have the cushion cribs. You know where I slept when I was an infant? A dresser drawers. I started squealing, my mom shut the damn drawer. I turned out okay. We all live through pain. Who doesn't have a BB inside them to this day?
My father was a doctor, which means I was a hypochondriac. How else are you gonna get their attention? Now, am I going to tell? Okay, let's do it. When you grow up with a dad who's a doctor, you have access to other doctors. And, well, here's the story. I was at college. I was a sophomore in college. And somewhere about a month or so before Christmas break, I decided that I had MS. So I started calling my father. I'm like, Dad, I have MS. And he's like, you don't have MS. I'm like, how do you know? How do you know? You haven't examined me. I don't know how you would know that. He goes, I know you don't have MS. He goes, what are your symptoms? I'm like, I don't know. My hands are tingly. He's like, you don't have MS. Are you drinking coffee? I'm like, I drink coffee. It's probably coffee. He's like, no, I have MS. And then, okay. So he hangs up. And then like a couple weeks later, I'm like, I call him up. I'm like, I have MS. I'm still have MS. He's like, you don't have MS. And then that ends that conversation. Then like a week before, I call him up and I'm like, Dad, I have prostate cancer. I have prostate cancer. He goes, how do you know? It's like, I don't know. It hurts down by my balls and stuff. And like, I think I have prostate cancer. It kind of hurts my on my butt cheeks and stuff. And he's like, you don't have prostate cancer. I'm like, I do. And then I called him every day for a week. Just like, I have prostate cancer. I have prostate cancer. It's like, you're too young for prostate cancer. I know I have it. So I get off the plane when I go home. It's like 6 or 7 at night. And my father says, we're going to Bob Rosen's house to get you examined. This is a urologist friend of his. So he's taking me to a man's house to be examined for prostate cancer. So he picks me up at the airport. He's like, no, we're going now. I'm like, I don't think that's, why can't I just go to his office? No, you have prostate cancer. We're going to go now. So we drive to this guy's house. He doesn't know we're coming. So we walk up to the door. My father knocks on the door. And Bob literally is like, he shows up. He's got a napkin. He's wiping his mouth. I see his family's at the dinner table. My father goes, my son thinks he has prostate cancer. Can you take a look? And Bob's like, I don't know. What do you mean? He's like, well, come on in. And then he goes back to the table. He puts a napkin down. And then he walks me and my father into his bedroom. And we're all standing there. I'm like, this in any other situation would be illegal. Whatever's happening, whatever's about to happen, this is bad. And thank God, Bob says, you know what? You should probably come to the office. I don't think this is the place to do this. And my father's like, are you sure? Is that all right with you, kid? I'm like, yeah, it's probably better. All right, so Bob didn't finger bang me in his bedroom. With my father watching, nonetheless. So this is how I cured my hypochondria. So I go to Bob's office. Does the horrible examination. It's very difficult. It's, you know, when you're a man, this is, I know women have their thing, but I'm not a woman. I know that as a dude, I got to go in and get finger banged by a guy, you know, once a year in a clinical way. But it's always awkward. It's never a pleasant situation. The most awkward part about it is like you get to a certain age where it's about to happen and there it goes in and you're like, oh, I kind of get this. Wait, I'm not changing my life. So, but it does seem to do something. But okay, so he gives me the examination and then, you know, he diagnosed, you know, it's really hard. I don't want to go into it. It's too, but he does the examination. Turns out I had something. I had something, huh? Yay. I had some sort of prostatitis, which my dad gets to. It's some sort of, you know, sensitive to it or what. So I had something. Great. I was right. Now, what happens next is a week later, it's supposed to be gone, but I still feel it, right? So I go into Bob's office and I go, I think I still have it. He goes, no, you've been on antibiotics for 12 days. It's gone. I'm like, no, I'm pretty sure that I have it still. He's like, no, you don't have it. I'm like, I don't know. He goes, you want me to examine you again? If you have to. So he does it again. I do it again. I get finger banged by Bob Rosen again. Twice. Okay. So now, like, another week goes by. I'm about to go back to school, and I decide I have herpes on my cock. Now, the irony of this is I had not had sex. I'd somehow gotten it from something. It was a unique case. So I, you know, sadly, I probably just jerked off too hard. That was the sad part about it. Like, all right, anyways. Look, I didn't want to do this story. All right, so now I got to go back to Bob Rosen. So this is like, I've been at his house. I've been finger banged by him twice. And now a week later, I'm going back with herpes that isn't even there. So I go into Bob's office and I go, he's like, what's up? And I'm like, I'm pretty sure I got herpes. Have you had sex recently? No, I've never had it. And then how do you think you have? I just think I have herpes. And so he goes, all right, take your pants down. So I take my pants down and he sits down. He rolls up one of those chairs, you know, and he's got my cock in his hand. He's holding my cock. And he looks at it and he goes, you know, there's nothing here, Mark. Do you like coming here? And that ended my hypochondriacal period. That was the end of that. Nip that in the bud.
I do not know how to flirt with daddies. I don't know, because my own relationship with my dad is dog shit, right? Like, my only exposure to daddies has been sitcom daddies, and that doesn't translate. That's not sexy. I can't walk up and be like, hey, I saw you there on the train, and I thought maybe if you feel like it, we could take a walk in a park, and then, you know, you could teach me to throw a football, huh? No? Hey, I thought if you're feeling up to it, maybe we could drive out to like an abandoned parking lot, and you know, if the mood's right, maybe you could show me how to parallel park, because I don't know how to do that. Hey, I saw you on the train, and I sure hope this isn't too forward, but I thought maybe you and I could go on back to my place, and then if the chemistry's there, maybe you could have my dog put down and then explain death to me conceptually.
I read all those books too. I read all those. I wish they taught me things that I wasn't expecting when I was a father. You know, like how to hold a baby in a porta potty. Yeah, it doesn't seem important until the moment it is. I almost squeezed my infant son to death for fear of dropping him into that never-ending pit of despair that is a public park porta potty, man. If I'm totally honest, I wasn't even worried about him. I was worried about me, okay? Somebody sees you drop a baby in a porta potty, your life is over. Society doesn't want you anymore. You're gonna be on the evening news, local man drops baby in porta potty. Hear me out, just hear me out. But here's the deal, like, if nobody sees you drop a baby in a porta potty, he's fine. He's fine. Pull him out, hose him off. He's fine. He's absolutely fine. Maybe a little pink eye, but other than that.
One night during the pandemic, I was watching a vampire film, and I didn't get scared at all, but I thought the coffin looked really comfortable. Anybody else? It's lined with satin. There's a little pillow in it. Lid closes. Very quiet inside, from what I'm told. If Costco could make one with a television by your feet and a little slide refrigerator, I would buy one. I just put it in the garage. The kids would be like, where's dad? He's in the coffin. Watching TV. Having a beer. He earned it. A little lock, maybe a locking mechanism on it. Daddy, what are you doing? And then if you do die, easy disposable. No mess. No mess. Just back the truck up to the garage. Beep, 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 beep. Push that out. During the pandemic, one of my buddies had a stroke. I know, he's okay. He survived. He survived. But to save his life, they put him into a two-week induced coma. And we were all talking about it. We were super scared for him, and everyone was really nervous. And they were talking about, you know, what's going to happen and what's going to happen. But I kind of blanked out right in the middle of our conversation. And then for 1 second, I thought to myself, man, that two-week induced coma sounds fantastic. I started asking questions like, hey, do you have to have a stroke to get the coma? Or can you just order that a la carte? How does that work? Does insurance cover that? And,
my Haley Bailey's 22 years old. She's got her degree from Oklahoma State University as well. Just like her mom and her sister, and she graduated last May, and she needs a job. Now, I gotta get that kid off the payroll soon, man. Cause it's gonna be hard to marry that one off, cause the guy's gotta fall in love with her forehead. See, you're judging and you don't even know. She's probably the prettiest one out of the litter. She truly is. But we gave her a cell phone way too early, right? Yeah, her sister got one at 16. She got one on the same day at 13. As a daddy, I was opposed to it. And now I haven't seen two of her eyes since, y'all. They just been buried down in that phone. I figure the guy's got to walk into a bar and go, look at the forehead on that one. Dude, check out her thumbs. They are huge. And I bet they're fake. Pixar joke number one, if you keep it up. And then my youngest daughter, that's my Audie Gray show, and she is 12. I got them 31, 28, 26, 22, and 12. I have four that completed college and one that completed the sixth grade. You know what that's like? That's like running an entire marathon. You get to the finish line, somebody stretches out the yellow tape and then goes, dude, don't hit that. That ain't for you. You hop in the truck. We gonna take you back to the starting gate.
We won't go back to the starting gate.
Audie Gray's a son. She was named class president last year, sixth grade class president. Yeah. The very first day in office, she erased all of her emails and built a wall between them and the fifth graders. Got the fourth grade to pay for it. Then she ran into a little scandal. She had kissed a boy in second grade and been paying him off since. If you guys got cable, that joke would rock. Audie Gray's is something. She's the only one I ever had to go to the schoolhouse over. I'm not saying my other four kids are perfect angels. I'm just saying they never got caught and got their daddy involved in the thing, right? Third grade, I get called to her classroom, walk into her little classroom, and her teacher looks at me and goes, do you realize your daughter is a class clown? I got a tear in my eye, y'all.
Are you serious?
The other four are really smart. Finally, one of them falling in her daddy's footsteps.
I like my kids. I like them a lot. They don't like me. They don't. If you like someone, would you walk up to them when they're reading the paper and just tear it out of their hands? No, you wouldn't do that. Would you cock block them every night of the week? Not to someone you liked. They just look at me as a source for food, and they'll lie right to my face, right to my face. They will. They don't care. They don't care. This is the thing. You love kids in an uncontrollable way. Like, if you love another person, you're in love with your guy or your girl, you can control. You can put the brakes on. I'm going to love her this much. I don't want to expose myself. I'm going to keep it back. Kids, there's a cascading love. It's helpless. You will kill for them, and you're in free fall. And they look at you like, nah, I could do better. If I get some of those keys that he's got, I'm out of here. My little one came up to me last week. I want some Teddy Grahams. Give me some Teddy Graham. No, you just had Teddy Grahams. No, I didn't. Yes, you did. I gave them to you. Now, why you gotta go make me upset? Just get me some Teddy Grahams. What are you, a little white pimp? Who's in my kitchen? Just give me some mother-loving Teddy Grahams. What are you jibber-jabber? I would just give them dang 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 dang. My arms were long, I would get the Teddy Graham myself. Why are you gonna be, who are you in my house? But I found something out. If you ever end up with kids and you want a little advantage over them, raise them here in New York, because the weather is so bad, it creates gloomy children, it's perfect. We were in LA and the sunshine, the kids were so filled with joy and hope and energy and every day, can we go to the park? Can we throw a ball? Can we go in the pool? Can we? Annoying. Here, they just sit in the apartment and stare out at the rain for hours. And they just watch the water falling, and they get all sad and pensive and contemplate what went wrong in their first 7 years on the planet. And they realize, I can't help, and I'm just reading a book, and I'm happy. So much better. It is. It's so much better. Listen, I don't care if kids play. That's cool. I'm fine with that. But now, this culture, parents are supposed to play with the kids nonstop.
I don't understand. That never happened. It was kids and grown-ups. Don't you remember that being a thing? Like when we weren't all the same? Don't you remember? Right? My father wasn't some hired party clown when I was a kid. He was the father. He was the dad. That was a different deal. He was the king of his castle. He was. And that's what I thought I'd be. I'm like, all right, I'm going to have kids. I'm going to be the king of the castle. I'm going to make people and rule them. That doesn't exist. That's an old version of dad. There's a new kind of dad now. Now you're part mom, part dad. You're like this useless hermaphrodite just hanging around the house. There's no respect for fathers. Even the cartoons the kids watch. Here comes dad. Bam, 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 bam. What a douchebag. Bam, bam. Do you remember your father coming home from work? It was like the bad guy coming back to the town in the Wild West. My mother would gather us in the kitchen. Your father's coming. Don't look him in the eye. He's gonna take your head right off. He loves you. He just doesn't want to see or hear from you. I get home, it's like the camp counselor just got there. Here's the kids. I'm going for a massage. See you later, jackass. Okay. My father would lay out in the middle of the playroom, just sleep. In the middle of the playroom, just on the floor, just lay there. My mother would, it's your father. Shh, get out of the house. Get out. It's your father. He works hard. Get out. It's raining. Get out. I try and sleep in my house. People are poking me in the face. Literally, opening my eyes. Are you awake? Are you awake? We need you to hook up the Wii. Hook up the Wii. Hook up the Wii. Hook up the Wii. Hook it. Hook it up. Hook it up. I hide in the bathroom. That's my only place to hide. I pay for the whole place. I sit in the bathroom like an idiot. And they start pounding on the door. And like a normal person, if someone doesn't answer, oh, they're busy, I'll come back later. No, they get on the ground, two eyes looking up at me. The other one starts wiggling fingers underneath. Then the cat gets involved, the paw comes under. It's like an attack of the needy idiots. And it's our generation is completely infantile guys. I don't understand why we're not grown-ups. You should see these dads at the park. They dress like the kids. They're in Converse, and they're dressed exactly like their little six-year-olds, and they're high-fiving and trying to be cool and accepted by the eight-year-olds. Woo! Are you kidding? I've waited my whole life to be a man. I want to sit in the park on a bench and smoke a cigar and drink a martini and have my kids look at me from the swings and think, I'm not going to even ask him to push. There's no way he's getting up. And then the one time I do get up, it'll be special. I'll be like, wow, he loves us. And they'll tell their kids, and it'll be a thing. It'll be, remember the time when he got up and he pushed us on the half?
Oh, no, isn't that bizarre? Isn't that true, though? That's just what we go through with these little kids, and I love them more than anything. They're the best part of my life. I mean, truly, I talk about them, and every talk that I give is a speaker, and every show I perform is a performer because they inspire me. They make me better. I mean, when my kids, when I'm home, my wife's like, it's your turn now. It's your turn to put them to bed and to take care of this night. Your turn. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I got it. Because she is, if anyone knows my wife, she's Wonder Woman. That is for sure. I know. Oh, yeah. You might have read about her at the Target post that I wrote years ago. But she is Wonder Woman. And the thing is when I come home, I go, yeah, I got it. You go. And then, but I call her Wonder Woman because I'm like, I wonder where she went. I wonder if she's coming back. I wonder if we're eating cereal for dinner every night from now on. I guess. Very sorry. The ability I have with that, children. But my kids, you know, I go, so what do we do for bedtime, guys? And they go, we do Daddy Dinosaur. I go, Daddy Dinosaur, what do you mean? And they're like, do the dinosaur, Daddy. Daddy Dinosaur, Daddy. Now, some dads, they're so tired after a day of work, they're not committed to the bit. You know, they come home and their kid's like, do the dinosaur, and they're like, I love you, you love me. Oh! My kids, if I do that, they're upset because they know I can give much more. They know that I'm committed 100% to the bit. So they go, Daddy, do the dinosaur. I'm like, you sure you want the Velociraptor Jurassic Park kitchen scene? Are you sure you want that? They're like, yeah, Daddy, do it. I'm all...
for it.
And I chase him up the stairs. And then I go, quiet time, bedtime. For some reason, it doesn't work. They're up there like... What's wrong with you, children? They only take after me, not Mom. They're just...
I've overcome a few things in my life. Maybe stuff people can relate to. And, like, I thought maybe I should talk about when my dad died. I was 6. You know, and how hard that was for me. And... he used to always carry around a beer bottle, and just brings back bad memories. No, but I thought about talking about my dad dying when I was 6 and how much that hurt me and affected me, and then I realized he's still alive. That's a lie. In fact, he's like a really great supportive dad, which is kind of a burden growing up. It's just like, stop helping me so much, you know? Like, give me demons somehow. Don't make me make them all up. It's like he flew out from Seattle to see me. He's here tonight. It's just like frustrating, you know? Give me something to build off, you know? Give me a reason to drink.
It's fun being a parent. It's tough. Kids don't understand things. He's 2. Trying to potty train him, that's difficult. He doesn't understand the potty training thing. So he likes to just take his pants off all the time, which is awkward. Like, we're at Thanksgiving dinner. He just stands up in the middle of the table and takes his pants off. Everybody in the family is, like, completely mortified. I'm like, buddy, what are you doing? He's like, it's funny. I go, it's a felony. Put your pants back on. This is awkward for the whole family, little guy. You can't do it. But he is, he's a sweetheart, I love him. And I tell you, kids do the sweetest things sometimes. I think the cutest thing my son does, anytime he gets in trouble, anytime he's done anything bad, he hides behind his hands. Have you ever seen a kid do that before? I think that is the sweetest thing in the world. I was watching him, he's taking his cards, he's throwing them against the wall. I go, Joey, stop! And he just does that move. That is the best defense mechanism ever, don't you think? Don't you wish you could do that as adults again? Can you imagine that? You show up late to work, your boss is screaming at you, where have you been? You're 4.5 hours late. We had that important meeting. I think we gotta bring that back.